I want to share with you a visual explanation of storage selection theory. Storage selection, or SAS, is a framework for modeling how material is transported through a control volume, such as water through a watershed. It's particularly useful in situations where we're interested in how the outputs of a control volume are related to the inputs, but we don't want to characterize all the detailed processes connecting inputs to outputs. For example, we might have observed the concentration of a conservative tracer in the outflows and inflows, and we want to use this data to learn something about how much storage there is in the system, how that storage is turning over, and how old the material leaving the system is. Storage selection relies on one core assumption, that the material leaving the control volume at some time is a mixture of material that entered at earlier times. For example, the water discharged from a watershed today is a mixture of water that fell as rain yesterday, last week, last month, and so on. Just what that mixture is depends on two things. One is the history of when water entered and exited the system in the past. This determines what water could be stored in the system. The other is the storage selection function itself. This characterizes how the water in storage is selected to become outflow. Let's see a visual depiction of how this works. I'll walk you through a static image and then show you some animations illustrating the effect of different storage selection functions. Consider a time series of inflows. This might be precipitation on a watershed. The horizontal axis here is time, and the heights of the bars show the rate water is entering at each time step. The colors represent the concentration of a conservative tracer moving with the water. At some moment in time, represented by this dashed line, the water to the left of the line has already entered the system, and some part of it is in storage. SAS theory allows us to keep track of how much of that water is still in the system. Imagine all the water in the storage stacked into a column like this, with the oldest water at the bottom and the youngest water at the top. Water entering the system arrived at the top, and at the bottom is water that was already in the system before our simulation began. Note that the apparently perfect separation of water into different ages is just for accounting purposes. We're not assuming the system actually looks like this. The age-ranked storage, S sub T, is a measure of where a parcel of water sits in this column, measured from the top. We know when each parcel of water arrived, and so we know how old it is. A parcel of water's age-ranked storage is a measure of how much water in storage is younger than that parcel. Of course, there may be some water in the system whose age we don't know. This is the water that was in the system at the start of our simulation, and we have no information about how old it is. Nevertheless, we know that this old water contributes some of the outflow and some of the tracer we might be measuring, and so we need to assign it some concentration, see old. At each time step, the outflow of water from the system is some mixture of water drawn from this column. The storage selection function characterizes the relative rate water is drawn from each point in the column, like this. In this case, the SAS function says more water is drawn from the top of the column than from further down. The SAS function is actually a probability density function over the age rank storage. And in this case, the PDF is biased towards younger storage. If we know the total storage in the system, we know that no water can be drawn from any point below that total storage in the age rank storage column. Therefore, the SAS function must be zero below that point. We don't always know the total storage though, and luckily there are ways to use SAS functions where you don't have that information. Since the SAS function tells us the mixture of water in the outflow, we can calculate the rate of outflow of water of different ages. Since we also know the tracer concentration associated with each water age, we can calculate the concentration of that tracer that we expect to see in the outflow in our observations. If the SAS function we've used in our model is a good representation of how the system works, these predictions should match the data. Note that SAS doesn't predict the total outflow rate. You have to provide that data, just like you have to provide the total inflow rate. Consider a very simple case where the outflows are a representative sample of all of the storage without a preference for younger or older water, as would be the case for a system that's well mixed. This is represented in SAS theory by a uniform SAS function. Notice how the SAS function changes in time as the total storage in the system changes. When the total storage increases, the uniform distribution has to stretch so that water is still drawn evenly from all of the storage. A consequence of this is that the fraction of discharge drawn from the youngest, say, 100 millimeters of storage decreases. This is called a direct or normal storage effect. Here's a very different case, where the SAS function is skewed so that there's a bias towards older water in the outflow. Most of the water remains in the system until it's older than almost all the other water in storage. We could go further to the extreme case where only the very oldest water is removed, a situation often referred to as plug flow or piston flow. This would be represented by choosing a Dirac delta function as the SAS function. SAS allows us to characterize more complex types of transport, like that one shown here. In many cases of interest to hydrologists like me, the SAS function is skewed the other way, showing a preference for younger water, like this. Notice how much longer the old water is retained in this case compared to the previous ones. Much of the outflow is water that has spent only a short time in the system, but even at the end of the simulation shown here, some non-negligible fraction of water in the outflow was already in the system to begin with. Here's an even more skewed case, where the youngest part of the storage is contributing the majority of the outflow, and the total storage is so large that it doesn't even appear on the plot. It's below the bottom of the axes. When the storage selection is skewed like this, conservative traces measured in the inputs and outputs can often tell us a lot about the turnover of young water, but they may not help us estimate total storage. In cases like this, it's been useful to avoid ever having to estimate the total storage by parameterizing the SAS function using distributions that decay asymptotically, like the gamma distribution shown here. In fact, studies have shown that in real watersheds, the SAS function doesn't vary in time with total storage the way the early examples you've seen here might suggest. The SAS functions that characterize their transport dynamics do have to vary in time, sometimes showing more preference for younger water and sometimes for older, but unlike the earlier examples, they tend to show more of a preference for the youngest water when the storage is high. This is shown in this example. Notice how the fraction of discharge drawn from the youngest 100 millimeters increases when the storage is high. This is the opposite of what we saw in the uniform case. We call this the inverse storage effect.